Jackie, a 10-year-old from Ohio, was originally born as Jack. As a toddler, Jack was drawn to his sister's dolls and clothes and enjoyed dressing up in tutus. Turning 10 with tears in his eyes, he said to his parents, "I'm a girl on the inside." Within months, with his parents' help, Jack became Jackie. Tonight, 2020 is there as Jackie navigates her transition and meets relatives for the first time as a girl. Soon she'll begin taking puberty blockers, a controversial treatment to prevent her from going through male puberty.
In a very small town in rural Ohio, a place long on tradition and family values, a baby is born in the winter of 2001 who will change a family and a community. His name is Jack.
I was looking forward to raising a boy and throwing the ball around and going fishing, things like that.
Oh, Jack.
His parents, John and Jennifer, practice law in a firm John's father founded. They already have a daughter when Jack comes along. But early on, by the time he's only 18 months old, it's clear Jack is not a typical boy.
And I tried to get outfits for boys too, the fireman, the G.I. Joe. We had superhero costumes. Never ever wanted to put those on.
He adores the color pink. And he loves dancing in ballerina outfits and trying on frilly, sparkly tutus. At birthday parties, Jack lights up when he receives brand new Barbie dolls.
Barbie!
Tossing aside toy trucks. His sister, Sagan, is the first to ask the question.
When we were little, I said, "Jackie, do you really want to be a girl?"
The thought had crossed our mind that Jackie may be gay. And we were both okay with that. We didn't have any problem.
Yeah, I think Jackie was 2.5 to 3, and I started looking online just to see if I could find any information. And I found out what transgender was at that time, and I was kind of I wonder.
In elementary school, life is already tough.
Jack would get teased by other kids at school. They'd call him gay boy.
And they had since first grade.
Finally, a week after turning 10 years old, Jack, with tears in his eyes, tells his mother he has something he needs to say.
And I'm like, you know, what is it? I don't know, it's not easy. I have to tell you something. I'm like, so I'm okay, tell me what you want to say. He's like, I'm a girl and I can't do this anymore. So, and I just, you know.
What did you say?
I just say it's going to be okay.
But in truth, Jennifer and John are not so sure.
Well, it's going through my head, we need help, and I need to learn all about this.
They decide they have to take action.
Shortly after Jackie made the revelation to us, we decided we'd go for a trial run. So we let Jackie dress up in her sister's clothes.
They permit Jack to dress up at home, but they make him go to school as a boy. Each day becomes a battle.
It was a meltdown and tears and I can't do it. I cannot put the boy clothes back on and go to school.
John and Jennifer find themselves at one of the biggest crossroads of their lives.
We thought that we might have to move to a different community just so that Jackie could transition and be a girl and nobody would know that Jackie used to be a boy.
I think you're using a little too much of that.
Jackie, go get a Kleenex.
Yeah, go get some tissue.
Dr. Joanna Olson runs a highly regarded transgender youth clinic at Children's Hospital in Los Angeles. She believes there is only one thing parents in this position can do.
It's really important just to support your kid.
And what does support look like?
It's different for each kid. I mean, there are kids who absolutely cannot function unless they socially transition.
And Dr. Olson believes that the earlier in life kids make the social transition, the better.
We often will ask parents, you know, would you rather have a dead son than an alive daughter? These kids have a suicide rate that is astronomical.
So there's no doubt in your mind that kids, little kids even, can feel that they're in the wrong body.
Absolutely. You don't make a decision about your gender identity. It's not something you decide.
Jack's grandfather, Richard, is not convinced.
I cannot accept that a 9 or 10 year old can make decisions for himself or herself that will be life lasting. I cannot accept that.
I knew I was a boy when I was 2 years old. I think everybody knows what gender they are at a very early age.
You don't see this as one of those childish kind of whims.
No, I certainly don't see this as a choice.
I think she was born that way.
She was born that way.
A month after Jack tells his mother he's a girl on the inside, Jennifer and John decide to allow Jack to come out publicly as transgender. He will no longer be a boy, hiding his secret life as a girl at home.
I don't feel like we ever truly had a son. We had a daughter that was unfortunately born in the wrong body.
Now, her name is Jackie.
Jackie takes a lot longer to get ready in the morning now than Jack did. That's been an adjustment,
mm-hmm.
I think, with the hair outfits. And the makeup and and needing Jennifer's help with it all.
You don't use the pronoun he anymore. You've abandoned it.
That's right.
Right.
So when someone you don't know comes up and says, how many children do you have?
Now I say I have 2 daughters.
She is poised to return to the 4th grade. This time as a girl. No longer Jack, but Jackie.
After the break, having decided to present to the world as a girl, we follow Jackie as she goes back to school and reconnects with her wider family, not all of whom approve of this life-changing decision. Jack, having made the transition to Jackie, must now face school. So, how will she be received? As well as heading back to school, Jackie will be reintroduced to her wider family, some of whom don't approve of her parents' decision to allow her to live this new life. The next step is a controversial treatment that will prevent the onset of male puberty.
Kim Bonnell is Jackie's 4th grade teacher.
Kids could be mean. You know, parents of kids could be mean. Would there be any teasing involved? Would there be any bullying situations?
Miss Bonnell talks to her 4th graders about tolerance and invites Sagan to speak to the class before Jack returns as Jackie.
Then I saw everyone crying, so I started crying. There were pretty much tears of joy because I was so happy that everyone was okay with it, and there was no, like, laughing.
It does appear that over the last few months, before our cameras, Jackie blossoms socially.
She's even more spunky and more silly and more sassy than she was before. Like, she just kind of came into her own.
Guess I'd say that this one's my top wig.
Prior to the change, Jack was the odd boy who played with the girls.
I guess like there and there.
But now, as Jackie, she's simply one of the girls.
Should I, with the skirt, go with this?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm trying to get an outfit for a pool party.
Anybody who says, no, I'm not so keen about a play date.
No. In fact, Jackie has had more play dates in the last 7 months than Jack ever had.
Miranda likes him.
Miranda and Aaron sitting in the tree.
K-I-S-S-I-N-G. Well, Jackie gets invited to birthday parties now and sleepovers and has play dates and has a social life now.
And while the little girl she knows seems to have accepted Jack's change to Jackie, Grandpa Richard remains unpersuaded.
Perhaps in the years ahead, there will be a reversal.
Jennifer's father is also deeply troubled, and it has caused a family rift.
He has voiced his concerns that, you know, if Jack chose to do this when he was 18, an adult, then that's fine, and I would accept that, but this is that Jack is too young.
But despite the disapproval of both grandfathers, Jennifer and John believe they are doing the right thing. But they are more than a little nervous this summer, 4 months into Jackie's transition, when they decide to present the new Jackie to their extended family at a reunion on Lake Erie. John and Jennifer emailed everyone in advance.
Hello.
And then...
This is Jackie.
You remember me? You were like young.
Kind of.
Aunts, cousins,
Nice to meet you.
Are all curious.
Hi.
I think some of the relatives were nervous meeting her as the girl for the first time.
I was a little bit shocked at first, and I was like, wow, I'm so impressed that we have such open-minded people in our family.
This is her grandmother.
I'm just seeing the same person dressed a little bit differently, longer hair, earrings on, and happy.
And as for her grandfather, Richard, despite his reservations, it's clear he's not giving up on his grandchild.
Bye, Grandma. Bye, Grandpa. Love you.
See you.
The weekend was a success.
Bye-bye, Daddy. I love you.
It's cold.
Bye-bye.
And Jackie's parents have made another huge decision.
I have Dr. Pepper in my bra.
This fall, they intend to put Jackie on medication that will stop her from going through male puberty. She'll be in the first generation of kids to undergo this controversial treatment, one pioneered by Dr. Olson. It is a risk. Not all kids who feel they're in the wrong body continue to feel that way through adolescence.
Do you understand that there are those, even in the medical community, who think this is a bad idea?
Every day. I talk to people every day who think it's a bad idea.
What's their best argument against your position?
I've never had anyone have a good argument against my position. So you're talking about a totally reversible effect, intervention, a reversible intervention that can be so helpful for people.
No one knows for certain what causes children to be transgender. Emerging research indicates there may be a difference in the brains of transsexuals. One thing is certain, the blockers will stop Jackie from developing into an adolescent boy, which at least now sounds good to Jackie.
I don't want hairy legs and arms. I think it's gross.
The next step will be taking female hormones. And once she's 18 and an adult,
I like bikinis the most.
Jackie will have the option of sex reassignment surgery.
I want breasts one day.
I love you both!
Wait, I need a kissy.
Are there still things that go through your head that make you worried, sad?
One of the biggest worries is, will Jackie find a mate, find someone to love?
I worry about that too, and I worry that she might be discriminated against in a workplace.
When you look in the mirror, who do you see?
A girl that's a person.
You see a girl that's a person?
Yeah.
Why did you decide ultimately to let us into your lives, and the hardest decision, into Jackie's life?
We don't think we should have to hide. We don't think this is a topic that should be hidden and swept away and behind a closed door. I think the lives and the quality of life for transgender people can be increased if more people just know about it.
Okay, next up, Kim Petras, a bubbly, fun-loving teen with a bright future as a pop singer ahead of her. She is using her music and the media to get her message to the world. Kim Petras is a burgeoning pop sensation and also the world's youngest person to have had a complete sex change operation. She was just 16 years old. Tonight, Kim talks candidly about growing up as a girl trapped in a boy's body and the struggle to be taken seriously. Through her music, she's reaching out to let others in a similar position know that they're not alone.
Kim Petras may be the newest up-and-coming pop sensation out of Europe.
There is no easy way, 'cause every way is hard.
With classic blonde good looks and a wholesome appeal, 1 million MySpace hits, and thousands of devoted YouTube and Twitter fans, the 19-year-old even has a new songwriting contract from Universal.
I think it's slowing it down, but it
feels... She seems poised for fame.
Did you cross over?
But there's nobody.
She wrote this song, The Real Me, just a couple of weeks ago, inspired by the struggles of the transgender kids who write to her.
It might seem hard, still so plain to see, this is the real me.
Because 3 years ago, at 16, Kim made headlines by becoming the youngest person in the world to have the penis he was born with turned into a vagina. That's right, Kim used to be Tim.
So,
Tell me about yourself as a kid. What were you like?
I always felt like a girl, and I didn't think that I was any different than all the girls, so it was really hard for me to learn that I am different. I was being bullied. I didn't have friends. I was a freak.
But no longer. Growing up with a supportive family, home was a haven.
So from the time you were little, I mean, your parents let you wear dresses because that's what you felt comfortable in.
Yeah, definitely. They just saw who I really was, and they didn't even care of the gender.
But this is the most stylish street here in Cologne. Like, all the hipsters are shopping here.
Her sister Sina and she are now roommates in Cologne, Germany. Kim spends her days hanging out with a large circle of friends.
Actually, she never was my brother. She was always Kim.
By age 10, Kim was already living as a girl with long hair, but still taunted and tormented at school.
I heard about this thing called puberty and wake up and be afraid that my voice would be deeper or would grow facial hair or whatever. I was just, every morning I was getting up and I was freaking out and I was just...
You were really afraid of becoming a man.
Yeah, I was definitely totally afraid. We went to doctors who all told me basically in the beginning that I was crazy.
They would say, heal out, grow it.
Yeah, and then even some people said, oh, he's probably just gay.
She's still biologically a boy at age 11, doing all she can to look like a girl. But by then, she found a sympathetic doctor who put her on blocker drugs that suppressed her male puberty. By 13, she started estrogen.
I got the female hormones, and, you know, that's a common age where, you know, girls start puberty, and so I was just developing the way a girl would develop.
But stuck in an undefined place between male and female.
So at this point, you're a girl with a penis, essentially.
Yeah, and I was feeling terribly wrong. I mean, it just didn't belong to me. It was wrong.
She was desperate for what's called bottom surgery to change her gender. Her doctors advocated for an exception to be made to the German standard, which forbids the surgery before 18.
Tonight, we bring you an incredible story.
She took her campaign to the media and was granted an exception.
I had to go to tons of psychologists and, you know, beg them to do it earlier and stuff. And they all saw that 2 more years of living in the wrong body would be really difficult for me.
So as you're getting ready to have the surgery, any second thoughts?
Of course, I was a bit afraid. Many people think that after you have the surgery, you're completely happy with your life. No, it's just you feel complete. You feel at the beginning. Because that's what other girls have when they are born.
So this is a very personal question.
Yeah.
Were they able to construct a vagina from the penis?
Yeah, sure. I mean, they do that since years. Of course it worked.
As for dating?
Do you have a boyfriend?
Oh, no, not at the moment. I had a boyfriend for 1 year, but no, it didn't work. Sadly.
But you're looking forward to that again?
Yeah, sure, definitely. I mean, I like boys. Who doesn't like boys?
So, no regrets?
No. I have never felt better. I have always felt this way.
I just wanna dance, drink, sing, and have a good time.
Although she says she doesn't want to be known as just a transgender musician, she says she would never hide her past.
Are there misconceptions, do you think, about transgender kids?
The one misconception is that you are sick if you have it. It's like it's a disease. It's not. I mean, it couldn't be healed.
There is no imitation.
Her music reflects her philosophy.
There are no limits and no boundaries. So why you want to tell me? My love is a disease.
Kim was afraid, she confesses, that having the surgery, becoming a girl, might make her a joke, might make others shun her. But the opposite has occurred.
What I learned from my story is that it's really important to speak about it because I get so many beautiful messages from people all over the world. Like, my music and my videos gave them a place where they belong. And that's really beautiful.
It might seem hard, but but still so plain to see. This is the real me.
Next on 2020, we watch as a family does the best they can to support their son on his journey to becoming a woman by going through 6 surgeries in 2 hours at the hands of a surgeon in Mexico. Vanessa is 19 years old, living and working in New York City, but Vanessa was also born as a boy. At first, her immigrant family had a difficult time accepting their son as their daughter, but now that she's decided on surgery, they've come to support her. But neither the family nor Vanessa can afford her transition, so she's turned to prostitution to pay for the body she feels she should have been born with. 2020 goes along with her to Guadalajara, Mexico, where $6,500 will buy her 6 surgeries in 2 hours as she struggles to become the woman she's always wanted to be.
Vanessa Rodriguez is desperate. Today, she's making a journey that is both risky and controversial, but it is a journey, she says, no one can stop her from making.
I guess I won't believe it until I'm there.
She is headed to LaGuardia Airport in New York for a flight across the border to Mexico for the surgery that will help her turn her male body into a female one. Because beneath the makeup, Vanessa is biologically a 19-year-old boy.
I don't want to go back to that awkward little boy that was shy and hid away from everybody.
Her father, Carlos, is dropping her off at the airport. He's praying she will not go through with this, but that does not stop her either.
Okay, baby.
I love you. Okay? Call me, all right?
Call me.
Vanessa's sister, Annie, says her little brother, Perry, started to change in high school.
People in his school made fun of him. They threw textbooks at him, and he had a rough time.
Life at home was tough, too.
I felt kind of bad for my parents, but, you know, it was hard for them to accept my son wants to be a girl.
Hardest for their mother.
I'm feeling that I lose my son. I get out of my bed and cry. I miss my son. I don't know where he is.
Her son spent his teenage years as Vanessa, moving through a dark and sometimes dangerous world in which transgender teens sell their bodies. It funded her drug of choice, black market hormone injections, to feminize her.
My time, it's $200 for the hour and $150 for the half. Is that okay with you?
Now she saves up for her new body by selling her old one in cheap hotel rooms.
All right, that's fine. Give me a call when you're like 20 minutes away so I can freshen up for you.
She calls herself an escort.
What really gets your attention is the pictures.
She says her clients are straight men who know she has a penis.
It was heartbreaking for me to find that out, you know, that she was doing that. I remember telling her, like, there's other ways, but she would ask me, what way? You tell me and I would do it. I had no answer for her.
I see it as a big sacrifice I have to make, but it's worth it now because I'm getting my surgery.
And so finally, it's time. Vanessa has landed in Guadalajara, Mexico's second largest city and a rising hotspot for medical tourists. Vanessa is taken straight to the hospital. As she checks in, her doctor appears, Dr. Sunny. A couple of her transgender girlfriends who know all about transitioning on a budget recommended him. His preoperative consultation is brief.
I'll take a shower then.
I have some time, baby, because my team is staying ready for you.
The doctor is all business. There is no preoperative workup, no blood tests, no EKG.
It's okay, pay me now.
Yeah.
In the States, this surgery could cost upwards of $30,000. Here, it's $6,500 cash. She tells us she's not yet ready for so-called bottom surgery to remove the penis she was born with and create a vagina. But a more feminine face and a shapely body, she craves. We should warn you, Vanessa's surgery is graphic. First, her breasts. Dr. Sunny puts in 700 cc's of silicone, which Vanessa hopes will take her to around a D cup.
This is my patient try today. And this day, we have 4 surgeries more.
5 more procedures to go. He removes her Adam's apple, breaks and rebuilds her nose, and shaves down her jawline, all in just a couple of hours.
6 surgeries in one time is no problem. Yeah, because I work very, very fast.
Doctors we spoke to here in the States said procedures like this would take more than twice as much time in the U.S. But for Vanessa, it's worth the risk. Heavily sedated, she calls home.
I finally did it. I'm happy, Daddy, I did it.
10 days later, her father and sister are on their way to the airport to pick up the new Vanessa.
Can't wait. And I'm pretty sure she got herself all dolled up.
And there she is.
Oh my God, I missed you. Oh, I'm sorry.
Me too, I went like this.
On the car ride home, Vanessa explains she's getting used to her new body.
This jiggling, I never felt that before.
She got big boobs now. You know, now she can wear her clothes and not have to wear, like, you know, before she would, like, wear, like, 2 bras so you can look.
She may not look so very different on the outside, but the surgery seems to have given her a new confidence. Her mother has been waiting in the house she raised her little boy. Today, she's decided she will do all she can to make her new daughter feel welcome.
Welcome home, Vanessa.
Welcome home. No matter what, I love her.
Yay.
Because that's what she needs right now, love.
But Vanessa won't be staying home for long. She now wants a few more procedures, including brow bone surgery and lipo. That means more money, and so she has decided more sex work.
One more year.
One more year.
Maybe even, yeah.
I can hear people at home screaming, stop now while you can get out.
I'm doing what I have to do to survive or to be what I want to be. And
you could get a job at McDonald's tomorrow.
I guess.
But for now, it's back to the cheap hotel rooms, back to the dream that more surgery will make her whole.
Thanks for all your feedback over the past week. We're interested in your stories, so keep those ideas coming in. That's our show for tonight. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next week.